Hello students, looking at current affairs for 4th May, the important topics which have been picked up from today's news items are these which will be covered in this video. So starting with it, these are news items picked up from the Hindu newspaper and these are the 7 headlines which have been picked up. The last two you should know they are from the Sunday newspaper. Sunday paper has a separate page called FAQ, frequently asked questions, which has important topics of the week detailed out. So these are the two news items from that. So starting with it, the first one, central health teams to monitor 20 districts with heavy caseloads. So total number of confirmed COVID-19 cases now on 4th May as of the data available is, it has crossed 40,000. And now India is one among 16 countries that have crossed 40,000. 40,000 people in India have been infected. Of course, it is the second most populous country, so the figures would be high. And India currently has, it is said, 28,070 active cases and 10,886 patients have recovered. And the number of deaths have also gone up. It has crossed 1,300 now. Also, center has announced the formation of central public health teams to investigate 20 districts in 10 states which have registered maximum number of cases. And out of these, you can see 3 are from Maharashtra, Mumbai, Pune and Thane, 3 from Gujarat, Ahmedabad, Surat and Vadodara. Then from MP, we have 2, Indore and Bhopal, and 1 each, you can see. And in Delhi also, it is Southeast and Central Delhi included. And then 1, and you can see AP also has 3, Kurnool, Guntur and Krishna. So there are 20 districts which are having maximum number of cases. And so central public health teams have been formed. These teams comprise of experts from National Center for Disease Control, AIIMS, JIPMER, All India Institute of Hygiene and Public Health. So these experts will submit reports to state health authorities with their recommendations to tackle COVID-19. So here you can see, Gujarat has the highest COVID-19 case fatality rate of 5.3% and Bihar has the lowest. You can see. Means number of cases and number of deaths which are taking place. So Gujarat MP top it. Then this is regarding how India has recorded more than 1,000 new COVID-19 cases. So how number of cases are increasing now in the later days of April, you can see. So daily cases recorded are shown, which has seen a spike in post 18 April, you can see clearly. And this is also deaths. Deaths have also increased since post 18 April. The next is Colonel Major among 5 personnel killed in Jammu and Kashmir. So in Jammu and Kashmir, in an 18-hour operation in North Kashmir's Handwara, 5 security personnel, including a Colonel Major and a sub-inspector, have been killed along with 2 militants too, who were shot dead. Then next is Javadekar slams report on press freedom. So Union Information and Broadcasting Minister Prakash Javadekar in a tweet has said that the latest survey of Reporters Without Borders, which is also known as RSF, Reporters Sans Frontiers, it is from France, it's headquartered in Paris in France. So this is an international non-governmental organization that brings out World Press Freedom Index. And the 2020 World Press Freedom Index was brought out on World Press Freedom Day, which is on 3rd May. So in this survey, India has been ranked 142 out of 180 countries. So even Nepal, Bhutan and Sri Lanka have been ranked higher than India. So the report talks about how there is police violence against journalists, ambushes by political activists. Many journalists like, you know, Gauri Lankesh has been killed by political activists. So these issues have been raised in the World Press Freedom Index report. And India has been ranked 142. In 2010, India's rank was 122. And then it slipped in the next few years to 140. And now it has gone beyond that to 142. You should know about the organization to Reporters Sans Frontiers. The topping countries, the top countries in Reporters Sans Frontiers is Norway, Finland, Denmark. And then comes little countries and you can see India lies at 142. And the last country is North Korea. So this is regarding the organization. It was established in 1985 and is headquartered in Paris, and it is to safeguard freedom of information. So it is to, its mandate is to promote free, independent and pluralistic journalism and defend media workers. So it has been inspired by Article 19 of UN Declaration of Human Rights, which recognizes right to receive and share information regardless of frontiers as an international right. So you should know this body, Reporters Sans Frontiers, has consultative status at UN, UNESCO, Council of Europe and also at International Organization of Francophonie. So these are countries which were ruled by France. So they have French language too. So the way we have a Commonwealth for British colonies, former British colonies, that's similar. We have this International Organization of the Francophone. So here also Reporters Sans Frontiers has consultative status. Then next is Center drafts new rules for satellite TV channels. So to overhaul its 9-year-old uplink and downlink policy for private satellite TV channels, now Information and Broadcasting Ministry, again the same ministry involved, which was involved in Press Freedom Index. So the Information and Broadcasting Ministry has issued draft guidelines with stringent provisions for any violation. So these draft guidelines have to be approved. So this guidelines has an additional clause that Ministry of Home Affairs can step in to revoke security clearance in case of repeated violations. So it means now it is giving a political angle to even private satellite TV channels, because if the number of references to Ministry of Home Affairs, which is clearly political in nature, happens, then this is going to discourage investors investing in private satellite TV channels in India. Also, violations which are being spoken of, you should know what violations are being spoken of. So violations include delay or non-intimation to the Ministry of Home Affairs about changes in the shareholding pattern of the company, appointment of a director without prior permission, so etc. These are showing logo or name which is not permitted by the ministry. So if any of these violations take place, an action needs to be taken, and all channels anyway have to go security clearance from Ministry of Home Affairs. So that anyway takes place, but now once granted, then clearance is valid for 10 years. But now the new guidelines say that the Ministry of Home Affairs can withdraw the guidelines. Means once you've been given permission, the permission can be withdrawn, and the permission to uplink would stand permanent, terminated automatically. This is that. So this has raised concern. Another change which has been done in the uplink and downlink policy is of relaxation provided for non-news category channels to broadcast live events. So they have to just register online at Broadcast Seva 5 days prior to the telecast, and they can broadcast online. But earlier it was required to be approved by Ministry of Home Affairs. So that aspect has been removed. Now it has been made into online provision. The next is Tripura groups oppose settlement of Brus. So you should know about Bru refugees. Bru refugees are actually a community from Mizoram, but they fled from there and have been staying in refugee camps in Tripura. So these resettlement camps has to be done, and permanent settlement in Tripura itself has been proposed by the government. Earlier, central government had given them incentives to come back to Mizoram, but then that did not give good results. So now the government has come up with a proposal to settle them permanently in Tripura itself, not asking them to go back to Manipur. So Tripura Chief Minister has now received memorandum from various groups. Tribal groups protesting this proposal to settle the displaced Brus in Tripura permanently. So here is the complete detail of this issue of the Brus and what is the scheme being announced, what will they get. So that's detailed out here, we'll see. So you can see the population of Brus in Tripura, Mizoram and Assam is shown. So though Mizoram still has few Brus, it has 1 lakh population of Brus, Tripura has 2 lakh. So it was in 1994 when Bru National Union was formed and it demanded autonomous district council. But then amid pushback by Mizos against this demand, so in Mizoram they were demanding an autonomous district council, but Mizos did not like it, and this organization took up arms and formed a Bru National Liberation Front too, and ethnic violence broke out a year later in 1997, and Brus had to flee Tripura, and they were living in refugee camps for now 20 years. So in 2005, you can see the organization, the militant organization, gave up arms also. Mizoram also promised to repatriate refugees, but then fresh clashes took place in 2009. So again, Bruce left Mizoram and settled in Tripura. So in 2018, central government signed a deal to repatriate Bruce with financial aid, but this deal could not see success. So now the plan is to settle them in Tripura itself, but then population from Tripura, some groups from Tripura are protesting against this. So this was ethnic violence in 1997, which made them. And this is the map showing the Bruce refugee camps in Tripura. So they are actually the largest minority tribal group in Mizoram. And they also live in Assam and Tripura. So they are in Hinduism fold too. And they migrated from Myanmar. Originally, they are from Myanmar. So Bruce are always tagged as outsiders in northeast, in Mizoram. That is it. So the benefits which the government has announced for them, you can see, is that each family will get 4 lakh in fixed deposit after 3 years of uninterrupted stay in Mizoram. But Bruce rejected that this 3-year caveat should not be there. So this was, the deal did not see much response. So that was if they shift to Mizoram. Also 1.5 lakh housing aid in 3 installments. Even money to build houses was to, this money to build houses, Bruce wanted this to be paid before they shift to Mizoram. So they can start building and then they will shift and live there. And then you had this proposal in the earlier government scheme of free ration for 2 years in Mizoram and monthly assistance of 5,000 per family. But Bruce said they wanted cluster housing in one place for security. But then government had said there are 3 districts earmarked and you have to go and settle there. So this was not acceptable. The deal could not be accepted. So that's why now the deal is that they should be settled in Tripura itself, not asking them to go back to Mizoram. But then this is opposed by Tripura members. You can see there is this Nagrik Suraksha Manch representing Bengali people of Tripura and Mizo Convention. So they both have submitted a memorandum to Tripura Chief Minister protesting against permanent settlement of Bruce in Tripura. Then next is Unicode nod for proposal to add Tamil characters to Telugu. So this is also from Sunday newspaper. This is talking about Unicode Consortium. So this is a body which specifies the representation of text in software products. So because every text, every letter like A, B, C and every symbol has some representation, some code in so to be used for software. So because everything has been digitized now, so this Unicode Consortium is important. And it's not just digitization, but in regional languages too, digitization is taking place. So that's why Unicode Consortium has this function of having a representation of text in software products. So which characters will be used, what will be the code to those characters. So there's this Unicode standard that assigns code to each character from different languages in the world so that they can be displayed across software platforms and clearly understood. So there is this issue which has arisen that some Tamil characters are required in Telugu texts, the old Telugu texts. So to preserve them in original, these Tamil characters would be required. So the proposal has been submitted to Unicode Consortium for this and Unicode has approved it. Here you can see the example of this text is also given. So this is a Telugu text, Aswar's Tirupavai, but they are Tamil text written in Telugu. So if this Telugu script is being used and we need Telugu letters for it too. So these Telugu letters are not in use. So that's why Tamil characters should be allowed to be used in Telugu. So that's the proposal. But then this has resulted in Telugu speaking population also coming up against this, that why Tamil characters have been imposed on Telugu speaking people. So this is regarding Unicode. How it assigns code to every character in more than 100 languages now. Even Indian rupee symbol is also called a Unicode character. It was accepted, the proposal was accepted in 2010 by Unicode Technical Committee. Then next is, can antibody test help tackle COVID-19? So actually COVID-19 tests which are conducted are RT-PCR. So that is real time reverse transcription polymerase chain reaction tests. So these are good tests for diagnosing COVID-19, but then these are costly, require a complete laboratory setup. So there is another test called antibody test, which can be conducted too. So these antibody tests are rapid testing kits. So they are like, pregnancy testing kits as such too. So they are used to detect antibodies. So it's an antibody test to detect antibodies, but then they are showing unreliable results have been seen in India in various states. So they have been recalled by ICMR. They have been actually procured from Chinese companies mentioned below. So there are these two Chinese firms which have provided these 5 lakh rapid antibody test kits to ICMR, Indian Council of Medical Research. So these are WANFO and LISMON. So they got the license to sell. And these rapid antibody test kits were procured and distributed among states. They have been deployed in some states. But then complaints came because they were showing wrong results. But Chinese companies claim there is no problem with the kit. It has actually been approved by ICMR's expert body as such. But then the concern with the test result is that the kit has, and antibody test has a sensitivity and a specificity. So sensitivity means that number of times the test correctly identifies people as positive for an infection. So sensitivity should be as high as possible. And specificity means the percentage of times the test correctly rules out those not carrying the virus. It means it should be sure of those who are and those sure of those who are not. So that is called sensitivity and specificity. So this is being hurt as such in the present antibody test kits, because of which they are being called unreliable. But then they are important too, because they will play a major role in determining degree of herd immunity in the population. What is herd immunity also we'll see. So rapid antibody tests are clear and give clear results, but then they are costly. And rapid antibody tests are cheap, can be easily done, on a large group of people. And what they detect is antibodies. So there are two kinds of antibodies which come from an infection. One is immunoglobulin M and immunoglobulin G. So in response to the infection, immunoglobulin M is first produced within the first week of infection, and then it is reduced and replaced by immunoglobulin G. So antibody tests actually detect these antibodies, means the body has been has contracted some virus. But then there's no clarity on which virus antibody is this. So that's why inherently antibody tests have this drawback, and even the states should have known how to use them. It's also been highlighted. So as you can see, it's a well-established feature of rapid antibody tests that in regions of low actual prevalence of a disease, they can, depending on kit specificity and sensitivity, miscategorize various number of those who have tested positive. So that's what is happening. It's not just in India. Complaints over Chinese kits have been raised even in United Kingdom and Spain. So this is there. Also, Health Minister Dr. Harshvardhan has said that by the end of May, the country will have India-made antibody test kits as well as RT-PCR tests. So we'll not have to depend on other countries. And this is regarding herd immunity. So what is herd immunity is important. So whenever a new pathogen, new virus or any pathogen is introduced in a community, it's new. So no one has immunity against it. But then it begins to spread. But those who recover and those who receive a vaccine, if there is one, they develop immunity. So for some time, at least they have the immunity. So with the coronavirus also, it's not known how long the immunity lasts. But then as there's no immunity in everyone, then some immunity develops in some people. So this immunity then spreads. Herd immunity takes hold when pathogen can't find new host and stops spreading. So that is called a time when herd immunity has reached. Now it can't spread because others are immune. So there's no more place for the virus to spread. So that means a sufficient proportion of the community is immune. So estimated range for this is said to be 55 to 82%. So 55 to 82% population has immunity, then it is called herd immunity. And the last item is this coverage on debt and mutual funds. So we had seen this earlier too in the end of March, that towards the end of April, that a special liquidity window of rupees 50,000 crore for mutual funds has been announced by RBI. So this was in response to the step taken by Franklin Templeton Mutual Fund. It actually wound up 6 debt schemes. six debt schemes with a combined asset under management of almost 26,000 crores. So due to COVID-19, it has been seen that the base is getting eroded. So these funds as such are seeing their losses values degrading. So to ensure that their values do not fall much below and to freeze them at a particular point, Franklin Templeton actually wound up these debt funds. But then this has triggered a question mark on entire mutual fund industry being affected, and they would also start, you know, taking such action. So that would bring a huge loss to the entire sector and the economy. So that's why RBI has intervened. It is said mutual funds as a combined have an asset under management of it's in lakhs of crores, you can see 15 lakh crores. So this has to be safeguarded, and mutual funds as such are allowed even to borrow 20% of the assets to meet liquidity needs, but then many of them have already crossed this limit too and they are in dire need for help. So now RBI has come up with this 50,000 crore liquidity window. But then this special liquidity window, actually RBI functions through banks. So banks will have to take these funds from RBI and provide funding to mutual funds. So, and this is exclusively for mutual funds. So means RBI is going to conduct repo operations with banks. So these operations of 90-day tenure at fixed repo rate of 4.4% for banks. So banks can avail funds from RBI and use it exclusively to meet the liquidity requirements of mutual fund houses. So they can give loans to mutual fund houses or undertake outright purchase of any collateral or investment grade corporate bonds, etc. So this is the announcement being made, but it has got a lukewarm response. Banks have borrowed only 2,000 crore out of 50,000 crore so far from RBI's liquidity window from mutual funds. So that is it. Thank you.